Good afternoon. It's my pleasure to welcome you at this session, session 15, this afternoon. So the first speaker of this afternoon is Professor Pingwen Zhang from Peking University, and he's going to talk about numerical mathematics of quasicrystals.
Okay. Thanks to the chair. So thanks to the ICM program committee to invite me to give a talk here. I'm very happy. Today, I will give a talk on the numerical mathematics of quasicrystal. Quasicrystal is a type of structure of materials. It's also physical concept and mathematical concept. I try to understand quasicrystal through the numericals and build a bridge between the physics and the mathematics through the through the numericals. This work is a joint work with Dr. Jiang Kai. He is my former student. Now he is working in the Shantan University. First of all, I'm talking about the background. First of all, talking about the tannins. What's the tannin? This is the current plan without gaps or overlaps. For example, this is the periodic tannins. We have the regular triangle hexagon, but if you use the pentagon, you can find out the gaps. It's a low way to low gaps. This is the, you say this is the tannin problems. Very famous is the Penrose tannin. This is the aperiodic tannin. No worries by translation. You see that we have the two diamond. One, the angle is 36. The other one is the 18. Then you can observe the beautiful plane. This is Penrose standing on the Penrose tannin. Actually, Penrose tannin is a negative example to the Hilbert's 18th problem. What's the Hilbert's 18th problem? You say this is building up of space from the concrete polyhedron. Quasicrystal is very famous from the 1982. Is by the Professor Schittmann. He got the Nobel Prize in the chemistry 2011, was awarded to the Schittmann for the discovery of quasicrystal. Actually, this is a material. You use the X-ray to see the structures from the different angle. From this angle, you can see this one somehow like the crystals. This is a hexagon. But if from a different angle, you can see this picture. This picture, you can see this is 10 symmetry. 10 symmetry is not the crystal, because the crystal is only symmetry is 2, 3, 4, and 6. No others. So from that, you can see different structure. This is totally different of the crystals. We call this is quasicrystals. So what is why this is important? The role of the quasicrystal. First of all, you see this is a crystal. We say periodic crystal. For the physician, important thing is the old. Why in the mathematically, is which type of function is good to describe of this type of structures. Another important thing is non-crystal. This is said completely disordered. But what's more, between of them, the first one is quasicrystal. It's nearby the crystals. Another important thing, this is unknown problems. This is bigger unknown problems in the physics. It's glass. What's the old for the glass? It's a big problem in the material science. And there are a lot of unknowns that actually, even for the mathematician, there are also a lot of unknown between the periodic function and just constant. What's about that? Now, I'm talking about the quasicrystals in the different angle. First of all, I'm talking about the mathematics. Then I'm talking about the physics. Experimentally, finally, I'm talking about the numerical methods, how to calculate the quasicrystals. First of all, we see the periodic. Everybody know cosine 2 pi x is a periodic function, like this way. Another function, cosine 2 pi square 2 x, is also a periodic function. But cosine 2 pi plus x plus the cosine 2 pi square 2 x is not a periodic function. We call this is a quasi-periodicity. So in general, almost the periodic function could be defined in this way. Actually, important here is the lambda. This is a countable set. This function could be expressed in this way. Cn and lambda n. Lambda n belong to the lambda. So, Meyer is a well-known mathematician. He got the prize, Gauss prize and Abel prize. Actually, in the 1962, 64 to the 1973, he worked in the quasicrystal from the harmonic analysis and the number theory. Actually, he published two books about the quasicrystals. Then he worked in the CZ operator theory, wavelets. Actually, he got this prize mostly based on the wavelets. He also worked on the Lefschetz equation. But from 2000, he's also recovered working on the quasicrystal and the applications. That's why I say quasicrystal, I think, is important to his life. So what's the Meyer's work? Actually, Meyer's starting point is the local controls the global for a function. It means this function, this super x belongs to the R, is less than by the local. The car is a local, but in this way. They say this is the local controls the global, like the periodic function. Periodic function, of course, this is local controls global. Fx expressed in this way. Here the lambda n, somehow the eigenvalue. So what's the problems? The problem is how to construct the lambda. What's the properties of the lambda? This is important thing. The trivial case is the fx is a periodic function. So before I talk about Meyer's work, we have to say what's the dynamo side. Dynamo side is a discrete point. The first one, this is discrete. What's mean discrete? It means give any small circle, they at most one point in the circle. Another important thing is the relatively dense. It means give you a large, little bit large circle, they at least one point inside. So that means dynamo side. This is discrete and relatively dense. So then Meyer gave the definition of the quasicrystals. He gave the three definitions. This is equivalent. The first a Mayer's quasicrystal, lambda is a diagonal side. Lambda minus lambda belong to the lambda plus F, where F is a finite side. This is the first definition. The second Mayer's definition is related to the algebraic number. If lambda is a Mayer quasicrystal, theta lambda belong to lambda. Theta is either a positive number or solemn number. This is algebraic number. This somehow like the, this is self-similarity. The third definition from the Mayer is from the harmonic analysis. By dual analogy theory, F is almost a periodic function. F when it's spectral, less in the Mayer's quasicrystal lambda. So there are three different definitions, but this is equivalent. So this is much easier to understand what's the Mayer's quasicrystal. We call this is a cut and project scheme. Actually, we have a high dimensional periodic lattice. This is a two dimensional. We have a rational slice like this way, tangent of equal to the 1 plus square 5 over 2. This is a rational number. Then we have this window. This window somehow like the 1. So then the points in the this window projection to the this is not dimensional, then you can see different laws. Actually, we say the not dimensional is Mayer's quasicrystals. Actually, this cut and project scheme can generate the tidings. Here, important thing is this number is a partial number. Actually, this number is a partial number. Somehow this is a cut and project scheme. This is an important thing to construct of the lambda. Actually, this series is a Fibonacci sequence. This is also important dynamically, in spectrum. Actually, like the quasi-periodic shading operator, we have here the Q, theta and omega is rational independent. For example, like 1 plus, for example, theta is equal to 1, omega equal to square 5, square 2, something like that. We say theta and omega is rational independent. This operator is equal to the dynamical system. Equivalent written in this way, the V could be written in this way. Then, the important thing is the spectrum. Actually, this is a hot topic in the dynamic system. Like Jin Gong is talking about 3 days ago about what's the properties of the eigenvalue. So, the first soft quasicrystals, actually, my research background is complex fluids. The polymer system is important of soft system. Actually, in the complex system, polymer system is observed of the quasicrystals. Actually, the first one is dendrim liquid quasicrystal. In this book, this is the building blocks. You see the polymer. Then finally, microscopically, you can observe the structures. Some of the structures is the quasicrystals. Actually, quasicrystal discovery in the two systems one will say the mechanical quasicrystals. Like the first one is the icosahedral in the 3D. This is the important number. Somehow is a irrational number. This is the symmetry. This is three-dimensional symmetry. This is dicogonal and dicogonal. So far, now more than 100 types of the structures. This one from the soft quasicrystals. Soft quasicrystals. The most of them is dodecahedral structures. It's a 12 symmetry. I didn't know why the reason. So this is from the experimentally quasicrystals. The tau is equal to the 1 plus square 5 over 2. This is a possible number. Actually, the lambda is definition by the this way. Tau square 2, lambda plus, minus tau, lambda equal to lambda. This is by the ray, by X-ray, the picture. From here, you can see the points. Here is the successive spots at a distance inflated by tau. Here is the tau square, tau power 3. You can see from here. So it's related of this number. So you can see here, experimentally quasicrystal is a subset of Meyer's quasicrystal. It means mathematically quasicrystal is much richer than of the physics. So the physical quasicrystal, somehow you say this is quasi-periodic crystals. You have a function, expressed in this way, somehow like the Fourier transform. But here, x is belong to the Rd, but the land expressed in this way, here a, if d equal to a, is the Fourier transform. But here, D and N is not equal. So the BJ is means reciprocal primitive vectors. Now I was talking about the numerical mathematics. First of all, I'm talking the projection method, Christian approximation method, and the one mode approximation. Actually, one mode approximation is a physical method. So what's the difficulty to computing of the quasicrystal? Actually, the first one, this is an infinite system without the decay. But use the computer, you are only working on the finite demands. You should have the suitable boundary conditions. You try to average the energy density to high precision. We need to put the different kinds of outer structure on equal footing. Otherwise, you cannot compare the different energy. So this is related of the Diophantine approximation. Approximate almost a period function, for example, like the this function, you can control by the this way. The Diophantine equality could be right in the this way. This is continued fraction approximation. It means this function, this AP function could be approximated by a periodic function. But if you include of the domain, then you reduce of the accuracy. So what's the CM? CM is a constant approximation method. This is used in the physics community. His idea is use a aperiodic crystal to approximate of the quasicrystal. Somehow, like use the aperiodic function to approach the of a quasi-period function. The frequency domain satisfies the Diophantine equality. Because, for example, like this is a 12-fold quasicrystal, here we have the irrational number. This is the accuracy of the 12-fold quasicrystals. From here, you have to use the Diophantine equality. So then the error of the CAM component 2. First is we say the finite approximation infinity. This is by the Diophantine approximation error. Another is we call it the numerical error. The numerical error is small. This table error somehow like the model error. For example, like a 2D 12-fold symmetry quasicrystal, we suppose the computational domain is L times 2 pi square. Actually, the L is depend of the irrational number. For example, for the this one, only the 20, the 30, 208, 410, this is a decrease. It depends on the irrational number. If you change it up to the 10-fold symmetry, the number is changed. The first one is 126. The second one is 204. This depends on the irrational number. This is by the Diophantine approximation. So if I use the CAM, use the Fourier spectral method, use the like this way, the computational complexity should be small because we hope the computational domain is small. But the small simultaneous Diophantine approximation error requires the L is large, is totally large. This is a contradiction. So what's the projection mass? It's our mass. The motivation is why it's simple. We try to avoid the Diophantine approximation. Now, we have a function like this type of function. We try to approximate. The idea is very simple. This is a one-dimensional function. We consider this is a two-dimensional function. This two-dimensional function is a periodic. So the idea is very simple. Because we can a lot of the Fourier transform is working very good for the periodic function. But now we're working in the high dimensional. This is the idea. So this is a 12-fold symmetry in Fourier domain. We have the irrational number here. We have irrational number here. But we consider in the four-dimensional. Actually, this is a two-dimensional problem. We consider this in the four-dimensional. We have four independent of the vectors. Q1, Q2, Q3, Q4. You use it in this way. This is a four-dimensional problem. Then, important thing, try to connect the two-dimensional and the four-dimensional by a projection matrix. The irrational number now is here. So it means you try to get a low-dimensional AP function. You're working in the high-dimensional, in the periodic function, and use the projection matrix. This matrix is dependent on the structures. then a DD quasicrystal could be embedded into an ND periodic structure. And then we implement in the free space in high dimensional. So then the frequency side, this is a high dimensional representation. We use the projection matrix. It connects high dimensional and low dimensional. For example, like this table 12, the fold, we use the projection matrix here. So for the 2D 8-fold, this is the projection matrix. 10-fold and 3D icosahedral, this is the projection matrix. This means the projection matrix depends on the structures. Now, the projection method could be expressed in this way. This is somehow like the free space. The land QC used in this way. Here, P, D times A. D is less than A. If D is equal to A, this is exactly of the free transform. We assume that the coefficient belongs to the D squared L2. Then we implement in an unit cell. But the unit cell, we didn't know how large is that. Periodic crystal is means the P equals the ID. That case is a simple case. So in the projection method, the energy density could be evaluated by the G theorem. For D-dimensional quasicrystal phi x, using the projection method expansion, we have this formula. Another important thing is the related cell, even for the periodic structure. Actually, we didn't know, now you have the six, for three-dimensional, you have six unknowns, three lines, and three angles. But we can make it in this change to the square. Here, we are induce of the B. B is a symmetry matrix, 3 by 3, symmetry matrix. It's exact of the 6. So it means try to minimal this table function. You transfer to the this table function. You study the quasicrystal in this way. Here, B is the 3 by 3 symmetry, the symmetry matrix. Then here the X belongs to the squares. Another important thing is one mode approximation. One mode or two mode approximation is used in the physics community. It means if you use this type of function, you only use the one function. For example, this one function, but the k equal to 1, just a few of function. Then you can do it analytically. Then you get the structure. This is like the hexagon. This is very simple. Some case could be done analytically. It means physics is always catch of the important thing. So this is a qualitative analysis. But a lot of physicians say qualitative analysis is quite important. This is available to the limited case. Because we are mathematicians, somehow this is not work. Now, let's go to the real model. First one, I go to the first field crystal models. The expansion of the free energy respect to phi. This is functional. This function, this we say this is bulk energy. This is like the lambda energy. this is the, we say this is the boundary energy. Somehow you say this is the elastic energy. This is the phase field model. For the periodic crystal, just one line scale. For example, the G used this way. We say this is just one scale. But for the quasicrystal, you have to at least two length scales. It means if just one scale, one length cannot be found of the quasicrystal. If you try to find out the quasicrystal, at least they need two length scales. Here, it means Q1 and Q2 is rational independent. For example, Q1, Q2 equal to 2 cosine 2 pi over n, n is 8, 10, and 12. This is the model. Of course, this is the phenomenological model. So the projection method can obtain almost exactly like density. Take the LP model. This is a very famous model in the GIS community. You see the GIS function. This is the elastic energy. This is bulk energy. Now you use the, suppose the gamma. Gamma, if goes to infinity, it means just this, the bulk energy important. The bulk energy is simple. Then you can use the one more approximation. So if you look for the CM, it means crystalline approximation method, for L equal to 30. So you can see the arrow. Actually, this arrow, we call this is the arrow is large. Somehow like the model arrow. For example, this arrow is dependent of L. If you change of the L to the 208, then the arrow reduced to the this way, but a little bit changed. If you use the large L, 410, then we can see the L is reduced. If you use all the projection method, they see this is the arrow. You cannot see. This means this is very good. But for gamma is small, the energy is much lower. You can see here. So it means the projection method, you can reduce the error, you add your requirement. So you use the projection method, you didn't have a Diophantine approximation. So, of course, we are scientific computing. The CPU time is quite important. Let's see the projection method calls this the CPU time. Here, right, is the projection method. Here is the CN, the 30. This is 208. So you can see the computational cost is very low. This is the error. Actually, use the projection method, the error is much lower than of the CAM because the CAM have the Diophantine approximation error. You can see this is almost fixed. Actually, the precision here is enough. It means 16 point in one dimensional is enough because this is a periodic function. Now, use the projection method can discover more quasicrystals. Actually, here, this is the trifold quasicrystals. This is the tenfold quasicrystals. This is the eightfold the quasicrystals. Computed by the projection method. In the But this is a two-dimensional problem, but you calculate in the 4D space. But we use of the 4D space. Every direction you have 24 points. This is the first diagram. Actually, physically, mathematically, you are interested in the stability of the quasicrystal. The quasicrystal stability for the material science, important thing is the phase diagram. What means the phase diagram? Because in the this model, let's see, you have two parameters. One is the epsilon, another is alpha. So let's see the phase diagonal. This is epsilon, this is alpha. Actually, in the original paper of left is the Patrick paper, this is the original phase diagonal. You can see the hexagon here, six-fold here. But now I use the projection method, calculate the phase diagonal. You can see this is the phase diagonal. This is the hexagon. You say this is six-fold phase. This is the crystal phase, periodic phase. From here, you can see the quasicrystals, 12-fold. Here, the tenfold. The eightfold is made stable, cannot see in the phase diagonal. This phase diagonal is quite important in the material science. Now you have very good projection method. You can calculate the phase diagonal very precisely. Now, let's change to another model. We say the 3D icosahedral quasicrystals. Actually, this type of quasicrystal is three-dimensional quasicrystal. It was observed in the first experimentally, Dr. Schatman. Now, you use this model. This is Bach energy, but for the elastic energy, you use the Gaussian polynomial potential. Gaussian, like use the this way. Here, this is the double well. The gamma is the G, like the, in the this way, is two of them. So different the numbers. This is the potential numbers in the position study. Now, we can use the projection method. This is the diffraction pattern of 3D icosahedral quasicrystals operated by the projection method in the 6D space. I direction use the 16 points, the modes, 16 modes in the 6D. Actually, we can calculate this, we do the computational just in the PC. This is structures. Actually, this structure is not easy to observe. Let's see, compare of the experimentally. This is by the X-ray observation. Here, now this is numerical, you have the structure. You do the same as the X-ray numerically. You can observe the structure from here. It's almost like the crystal, it's a hexagon. This is a hexagon. But from here, you can see the tenfold symmetry. So in the different angle. From here, you see the different patterns of the spectral mode. So if gamma goes to infinity, you can use the two modes approximation method. Then you can see for the different parameter, you can see this is two-fold in the nine manner. Here is 3D quasicrystal, 2D tenfold quasicrystal, and the BCC. BCC is a periodic structure. If gamma is finite, the tumor may be induced of the error. That time, we can use our projection method, calculate the phase diagonal. You can see here, this is uniform 3D quasicrystals and the QBCC. QBCC means the BCC, the length, it depends on one length, but it depends on the Q. From here, you can see the big difference. It means, of the gamma finite and the gamma infinite, the phase diagonal is different. From here, you can see algorithm plays an important role in the study of the quasicrystals. You can see the big difference. So now I give the discussion of some of the open problems. A lot of people maybe read this book, the Freeman and the Dyson, Birds and Frogs. In this paper, Dyson talking about the quasicrystals in the Neumann, maybe related of the Neumann conjecture. Actually, in this function, the Neumann conjecture say the zeros point should be in the critical line, but discrete. But this may be a quasicrystal. If we allow the structure of the points, so maybe we can know know more about the Neumann conjecture. So this is Dyson said, is not I said. Okay. Actually, 2 months ago in the Edinburgh, in the International Center for the Mathematical Science, they have a workshop on the quasicrystals, pattern formulation, and the aperiodic old. In this workshop, the different people, some people working on the mathematics, some people working on the physics, material science, number theory, and the dynamic system, we are talking about what's the quasicrystals. First of all, you say, what's the difference? The metallic quasicrystals and the soft quasicrystals. Somehow, metallic quasicrystals related to the tanning problems. The soft quasicrystals is related of the functional. So it's more continuous. It means somehow this table quasicrystal like the discrete. This table is related to the functional. Another important thing is the phase transition between the crystal and the quasicrystals. So because this is quite different problems. Actually, there are a lot of other problems. What's the quasicrystal in mathematical language? Actually, so far, Meyer's work gave a very good explanation. But this is, if you just use the quasicrystal in the Meyer's, is a little bit difficult for us. For example, why use the partial number, solemn number? Actually, in Meyer, he have to use the partial number and or the solemn number because this is by the Diophantine approximation, the control. Another for the projection method, what's related of the Cartan projection method scheme? This is a little bit different. Actually, so far, mathematically, physically, and experimentally, quasicrystal is a subset, is somehow subset. So if you try to answer quasicrystal, you need to know now about the mathematically. Which the physical model can produce the quasicrystals. So far, you just use the phenomenological model. For example, like the self-consistent field model is quite difficult to calculate the quasicrystals. Actually, important is more structure between the perfect crystal and disordered. It should be, but we didn't know how others, especially for the glass. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Zhang. So any questions or remarks? So let me start. Are there any important parameter identification problems related to quasicrystals in physical mathematics?
I think because first of all, for example, like the phase diagonal, the important thing, you have the mathematically the correct method to do the phase diagonal. Now you use if you use the projection method, you can say this phase diagonal is correct. Otherwise, I show you, if you use the other method in the physical community, actually the phase diagonal may be changed. So this is important thing. The projection method is a good method to calculate the phase diagonal for the quasicrystals.
Any more questions or remarks? If this is not the case, let's thank the speaker again. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.